Hello friends, let us continue our new lecture today on renal tuberculosis. So what is the etiology of renal tuberculosis? We know that tuberculosis is caused by mycobacterium tuberculosis. It mainly, renal tuberculosis arises from the hematogenous infection. Hematogenous infection from distant foci. These lesions are mainly confined to one kidney. This mycobacteria tuberculosis will infect the kidney cells, leading to the formation of granuloma. Many granulomas combine together or coalesce to form an ulcer. Okay, the mycobacteria or pus cells, these are discharged in urine. So let us learn the different types of renal tuberculosis, different types of presentation of renal tuberculosis. So here, number one, this is the kidney. Okay, I'll draw like this. So whenever there is a ulcer formation, that is tuberculous papillary ulcer, number one. The first type is tuberculous papillary ulcer. This is the first type. And the second type is so this form will, this is a cavernous form and it bursts out like a bombshell. So this is a cavernous form. It tends to burst out like a bombshell. Okay. So this is cavernous form. This is the first form, second form. In third form, there is the formation of hydronephrosis. This is hydronephrosis. And then the fourth one, there is formation of pyonephrosis. There is pus in the kidney. So this is pyonephrosis. So this pyonephrosis occurs whenever there is secondary infection with E. coli, etc. Okay, so that is the fourth type. And the fifth type is, so the infection that is there, pyonephrosis which is there, that bursts out and leads to the formation of tuberculous perinephric abscess. Tuberculous perinephric abscess. So here, that is abscess formation, like this. And now, later there is formation of calliculi. That is, because of fibrosis, there is calcified areas which are present in the kidney, which are called as pseudo calliculi, which are seen on x-ray. So this is pseudocalculi. On X-ray, we see them as calcified tuberculous areas in the kidney. Then seventh, there can be a kidney which has caseous necrosis and there are fibrous septa. So this is caseous kidney divided by fibrous septa. So this is the here there is caseous necrosis all over the kidney. Okay, so this can occur. And at the end, there may be, this is the last and severe form, where there is miliary tuberculosis. So miliary as a part of general process, general tuberculosis. So if you see in miliary tuberculosis, there will be many caseous necrosis spots in the kidney. So this is miliary tuberculosis. Okay, so let us once again discuss what is happening here. So here first there is a tuberculous, first there will be tuberculous granuloma that will coalesce to form a tuberculous ulcer. So this tuberculous ulcer will enlarge and it may burst into the bone shell, or it may form a hydronephrosis when this is infected superficially. Again, secondary infection when it occurs, so then it causes pyonephrosis, and then when this abscess bursts to outside, it may form tuberculous perinephric abscess. Sometimes the structure which is inside that may get calcified and it forms pseudocalculi, that is false stones, and later the caseous necrosis may occur, and there may be, it is progressively replaced by caseous material, that is, this is called as putty kidney. And this may be calcified. Whenever there is calcified, it is cement kidney. The areas of calculi are seen pseudocalculi. And then less commonly, this is infected as miliary tuberculosis. So once perinephric tubercular perinephric abscess occurs, so this here pus is replaced by caseous material. So this leads to the formation of caseous kidney. And once this caseous kidney is formed, there is fibrosis leading to the formation, fibrosis and calcification, leading to the formation of cement kidney or pseudocalculi. And finally, there is miliary part of the kidney. So here this bursts and forms that. And when this is infected again, this forms this. This cavernous form may burst and later it forms hydronephrosis. So these are the stages of renal tuberculosis and different types of renal tuberculosis. So now, this renal tuberculosis is associated with tuberculosis of bladder, and sometimes you can also see tuberculosis of epididymoarchitis. So what are the clinical features that you see here? The tuberculosis occurs between 20 to 40 years of age, renal tuberculosis, and it is more in men when compared to women, and right kidney is more commonly affected than the left, and the earliest symptom is urinary frequency. Urinary frequency, it is the earliest symptom. The patient will complain of increased daytime and nighttime. Daytime and nighttime micturition frequency. Okay. Now, there is here the patients with tuberculosis. They complain of sterile pyuria, in which urine is pale and opalescent with pus cells are present, but there is no organism. So if you culture it, it is negative. So this is called a sterile pyuria or a bacterial aciduria. Okay, then the next thing is presence of painful micturition. Painful micturition is a feature of tubercular cystitis, and this painful micturition, it can be associated with hematuria sometimes. It is a feature of tubercular cystitis, right? Now, first there is suprapubic pain. If voiding is delayed, only if voiding is delayed, then the patient will have suprapubic pain. Later, there is burning micturition. If there is secondary infection, then one can see superadded agonizing pain, which is referred to the tip of the penis. Referred to tip of penis or vulva. And it is associated with hematuria and stranguri also. And stranguri. Okay. Then there may be dull aching pain in the loin. Dull aching pain in loin may be there, and then hematuria. It is the first symptom if there is ulcer in the papillae, ulcer on renal papillae, as I have said. So normally tuberculous kidney, it is edematous and friable. Then there is malaise, weight loss, and low evening pyrexia is common. If there is high temperature, this will suggest secondary infection or dissemination. This is called as miliary tuberculosis. And then on examination, you see sometimes tuberculous kidney can be palpable. And also examine prostate, seminal vesicles, vas and scrotal centers for nodules or thickening. Okay, this is what we see on examination. Okay. So what investigations can you do? The investigations are, if it is bacteriological investigations, they include, number one, early morning urine samples, 3 early morning urine samples at least are sent for microscopy and culture. Microscopy, Zeal Nielsen staining for urinary bacilli, urinary for acid fast bacilli in the urine. And for culture, it is Lonstein Jensen medium, LJ medium. If clinical picture and the staining confirms it, then you can start antitubercular therapy. You can also do radiography. This radiography will show only calcified lesions, nothing else is seen. And you can see, you can do intravenous urography. This intravenous urography shows clear cut outline of renal papillae may become indistinct. Why indistinct? Indistinct. This is due to the ulceration. And then later there may be calyceal stenosis. So even that can be seen. Okay. Even there can be stricture formation, hydronephrosis. Those can also be seen. Then retrograde ureterography, it can also demonstrate the strictures which are there. Okay. Next, if you do cystoscopy, it is not a routine investigation. But it is often performed because there may be hematuria or unexplained bladder symptoms. Then we often tend to do cystoscopy, but it is not a routine investigation. In the first stages, there won't be much difference. It may be normal, but later there you can see granulomas in the urothelium can be seen, and even tubercular ulcers can also be seen. Okay, so we will learn what are the lesions in the bladder just in a minute. Then you can do chest radiography. The chest radiography, it is just to exclude the active lung infection. Okay, to exclude active lung infection, you'll have to do chest radiography. Then how do you treat it? The major treatment which you give is, number one, you will have to give anti-tubercular therapy for sure. Anti-tuberculous chemotherapy should be given. And then you will have to also see the urinary tract, whether it is patent or not. During the first few weeks of therapy, urinary tract is reviewed, because there may be the reason for reviewing urinary tract is because there may be formation of strictures in the ureter or pelvis even after the treatment is started. This might occur. So prognosis is really good. So now surgical treatment. Surgical treatment should be conservative. We should aim to remove the focus of infection, large foci of infection should be removed, and also you should correct the obstruction which is caused by fibrosis. Obstruction caused by fibrosis. This surgery, it is done after between 6 to 12 weeks after starting anti-tubercular therapy. After starting anti-tubercular therapy, after 6 to 10 weeks, 12 weeks, only then you will do the surgery. And then what do you do? So, if there is an obstructed lower pole calyx, if this is the kidney, if there is an obstructed lower pole calyx here, this should be drained into the upper ureter. If there is obstructed lower pole calyx, you should create a tract to drain it in the upper pole. That is one you have to do. If there is any strictures in renal pelvis, then you should do pyloroplasty. Okay. If you have any ureteric stenosis, you can do Boris operation, or even you can do bowel interposition as you do for ureteric injury. For this about the surgery, just refer to the lecture of ureteric injuries in my lecture. If kidney function is lost, if there is no kidney function, then it's not necessary to retain it, so you will have to do nephrourectomy. If the bladder is also contracted, then this is replaced by a neobladder, which is formed by a flap of bowel. Refashioned bowel. Okay, so this is what you can do for this thing. And if there is hydronephrosis, for hydronephrosis, you will have to do Anderson-Hinds operation. We have already discussed about this operation in hydronephrosis class. These are the different operations that you do, surgeries that you do for this kidney, tuberculosis kidney. So what are the indications of nephroureterectomy? The major indications of nephroureterectomy are non-functioning kidney, the disease if it involves kidney extensively, if this disease it is causing hypertension and obstruction, or if the person has tuberculous pyonephrosis, or if he has coexisting renal cell carcinoma along with it, then you will have to do nephroureterectomy. Right now in my lecture I forgot to mention the changes of the ureter and this mode of spread of urinary tuberculosis. So first let me mention the mode of spread of urinary tuberculosis, and then we will mention the changes that occur in bladder and seminal vesicles and other organisms and other structures. So mode of spread, that is hematogenous, we know that, but how? This is the lungs. So this is the kidney which is there, and then bladder, ureter, then bladder. Okay, from the bladder there is a seminal vesicle, and there is this one which is epididymis. This is epididymis and testis. Vast difference, epididymis and testis. So this is what generally happens. So how is that spread? So it spreads, starts from lungs, which is from the lungs. Lungs is the main focus. From the lungs, it goes to kidneys, which is the first. From the kidneys, it goes to the ureter, second. From the ureter, it goes to the bladder, that is third. From there, it goes to the seminal vesicles, that is four. Then it goes to the epididymis, that is five. So these are the five areas how it spreads. Okay, so first to kidney, and then it goes to ureter, and then it goes to bladder, and then it goes to seminal vesicles, and finally it goes to epididymis. So this is the way that the infection spread. Sometimes the infection spreads can spread directly from the blood into the epididymis also. So this is one more type of spread. So we have learned what happens in the kidney in this lecture. But the question is, what happens in the ureter? What happens in the bladder, seminal vesicles? I did not teach them, right? I forgot it. So let me tell you what happens in each of the organs. So in the ureter, this causes first, if you wanted to know what happens in the ureter, this is the ureter, this is the bladder. So in the ureter, it causes strictures, which is stricture ureter. And the most common site for stricture ureter is ureterovesical junction. First, and second most common site is pelvic ureteric junction. So first most common site is ureterovesical junction. Okay, so here you will have this stricture formation. So here in this you will have number one stricture formation and also ureteritis. So this is what is seen in ureters. So for stricture, the treatment of the stricture is removal of stricture. Okay, removal of stricture. So here you will just remove the stricture. And then if this position is more, then you can do Bowery flap technique if it is in the lower third, or you have to do the bowel interposition. I have already talked about that in my class on ureteric injuries. So please refer to that class for the better lecture of how these techniques were done. I don't want to go through them in detail in this lecture. So next, about the urinary bladder. So what happens in urinary bladder? Yeah, and second thing, this tuberculous ureter, whenever there is stricture in the whole ureter, then that is called as golf hole ureter. Okay, and now let me tell you what happens in urinary bladder, that is tubercular cystitis. In tubercular cystitis, what really happens is, if this is the bladder, ureter, whenever it attacks, you don't see golf hole ureter. You will see it in the urinary bladder. So I'm sorry for that. So here, this is the ureteric opening. This is second ureteric opening. What really happens here is, number one, there is inflammation. And then you see, first there is inflammation. And later, There is first with inflammation, there are ulcer formations and granulomas are formed. And after forming granulomas, you see fibrosis. So because of the fibrosis, it causes fibrosis in the bladder wall. So in the bladder wall, there is fibrosis. So this bladder wall fibrosis will cause dilated ureteric orifice. This dilated ureteric orifice looks like a golf hole. So this is called as golf hole ureter. It is because of this orifice, it is called golf hole ureter. And later, slowly, the entire bladder is fibrosed. Once the entire bladder is fibrosed, it forms stiff and it cannot dilate. And this bladder is called as thimble systolic bladder. Okay, so here what do you see? First you see fibrosis of the whole this bladder elements, this everything becomes fibrosed, and because this becomes fibrosed, this opening, it becomes dilated and thus it forms a golf hole ureter. And because of this fibrosis, it forms thimble systolic bladder. So this is about tubercular cystitis. Now we have completed what happens in the bladder. Now what happens in the seminal vesicles? We may have tuberculosis, prostatitis. Here you have enlarged prostate. Okay, and you may have seminal vesiculitis, tuberculosis, seminal vesiculitis. Here there is on PR per rectal, there may be palpable seminal vesicles, and there may be tubercular epididymitis. And vas will be beaded, and here epididymis is thickened with ulcer. On posterior aspect of scrotum, and vas is beaded, and that is called as tubercular funiculitis. So all these are seen. So because of all these, there will be sexual dysfunction, that is impotence, and infertility may be seen. Okay, so these are the things that you see in tubercular infection. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubt, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. In my next lecture, I will explain you about, we'll go to the carcinomas. So we will, I'll teach you about the first carcinoma of carcinoma. So first let us go to the benign diseases, and then we will go to the malignant diseases. So please subscribe this channel for more lectures. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.